Omarosa tries crashing Trump's Christmas message and spoof of firing on Saturday Night Live. Despite Omarosa manigault Newman's assurances that her White House departure was boring, Saturday Night Live depicted the ousted staffer's wild attempt to get her old job back. The former reality show contestant tried to break into the White House as Alec Baldwin's President Trump and Cecily Strong's Melania Trump decorated their Christmas tree with casualties of their tumultuous administration's first year during a lackluster cold open Saturday. Nobody kicks Omarosa out of the White House, bellowed cast member Leslie Jones as Newman, banging on the windows. Her demands fell on deaf ears as a team of Secret Service agents dragged Jones away, mimicking the dramatic sacking as described by sources this week. Newman apparently threw a profanity-laden tantrum when Chief of Staff John Kelly stopped her from having a word with the president during her firing. She then allegedly tried to force her way into the residence and was removed. Newman disputed the reports and said she resigned. When physical force failed in the sketch, Jones Newman tried to appeal to her old boss sympathy. She spoofed the emotional scene from the 80s flick Say Anything by hoisting a boombox above her head as it serenaded the Trumps with a theme from the NBC reality show. "I will always love you, Don," she cried out. Michael J. addressed Newman's unemployment during the weekend update, but was unable to describe what she actually did in the White House. It was announced that Omarosa manigault Newman was fired from her White House job, whatever the hell that was, Chase said. "My guess was Secretary of the Sunken Place." Jay mocked Newman by playing a montage of black TV hosts cheering her firing, most notably Robin Roberts' Sly Diss. "I'm sure she'll be selling that story," the Good Morning America host quipped, before adding a passive-aggressive "Bye, Felicia." "Man, when you get a bye, Felicia from Robin Roberts, you know you suck," Chase said. He then came face to face with the faux Newman as she tried to defend her departure. "I left that job by choice," she insisted. "I quit. I deactivated my ID card. I changed the locks on my own office. I escorted myself off the premise. And then I threw myself into the bushes. Thank you for watching. For the follow-up, subscribe to the channel yourself here."
Which, if you've ever Baldwin often stops by SNL to play President Trump,
but Ivanka does not have a regular portrayer on the show, though Johansson has played her several times. In 2016, guest host Emily Blunt portrayed Ivanka during the Beyoncé Sorry parody Melania Nod, a reference to Bey's acclaimed visual album Lemonade. Could Johansson's repeat appearance as Ivanka mean she'll be taking on the role more often? Fans and viewers can only hope. She seems to have a lot of fun with it, and Twitter is a fan of her impression. See Johansson's impression The First Daughter for yourself in the video below and into the holiday spirit. Either way, it seems like Johansson was willing to reprise her role as Ivanka just in time for the holiday season. Thank you for watching.
Mr. Hart emerged
for the follow-up, subscribe to the channel yourself
Mr.
here.
Mr. O'Neill's height. Kudos to Mr. Hart here. His portrayal of Mr. O'Neill wasn't spot on by any stretch, but it was fun. When asked what she wanted for Christmas, Ms. McKinnon said, "I want out." 80 Bryant showed up as Sarah Huckabee Sanders, the White House press secretary, with ornaments that featured mugs of her predecessors, Anthony Scaramucci and Sean Spicer, whose mangled corpses I stepped over to get this job. Vice President Mike Pence Beck Bennett was next in line, apologizing for slurring his speech. He blamed a ginger ale. Then came this exchange, prompting one of the show's loudest laughs. "Mr. Baldwin, are you here to deck the halls, Mike?" "Mr. Bennett, oh, I don't like that song because it mentions gay apparel." Omarosa manigault Newman, the White House aide, who left her job this week, appeared outside an Oval Office window in the form of Leslie Jones, before being promptly dragged away again. More on her later. Scarlett Johansson made a cameo as Ivanka Trump, offering an ornament of Roy Moore, the Alabama Republican, who on Tuesday lost his bid for the Senate. "I thought for sure he would win, until he lost, then I said I always knew he would lose," Mr. Baldwin said, referring to Mr. Moore. "At least America knows that I finally supported an accused child molester," Ms. Johansson responded, "as I said, there is a special place in hell, and we're all there." Kevin Hart's interesting monologue. Kevin Hart was the SNL host a three-peat, and his monologue focused mostly on having his third child. "I can admit to everybody that I wasn't excited about having a baby in the beginning. When we had the idea of having a baby, I wasn't thrilled. I didn't know if I wanted the baby. That's me being honest, don't judge me. In being honest, I didn't know if I wanted the baby. The reason why is because I have got two babies already. My daughter is 12, my son is 10. I told my wife, I said, babe, I got the best of both worlds. I did it. We married. So technically, those babies are your babies. That's what I told her. Those are your babies, too. She said, I know, but they are old, and I want new ones. I said, well, first of all, don't talk about my kids like they're used cars. Don't do that. Okay? These kids run perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with these kids. The monologue was interesting given that just this week, Mr. Hart had admitted on a New York radio show to cheating on his wife while she was pregnant. Ms. Jones returned as Ms. Newman during Weekend Update, insisting that she hadn't been fired. That's right, I quit, Ms. Jones said. I deactivated my ID card, changed the locks on my own office, I escorted myself off the premises, and then I threw myself into the bushes, and then a security guard showed up to once again escort Ms. Jones off the set, or maybe it was the other way around. You better take my arm, because I'm escorting you out of the studio, she said, referring to the guard, and you better throw me into the Christmas tree. This was the first SNL episode since it was announced that Colin Jost and Michael Che would become the co-head writers for the show. Mr. Jost, Doug Jones, has become the first Democrat to win a Senate seat in Alabama in over 20 years, said Roy Moore Gross. Over 20 years? Mr. Che, Democratic National Committee Chairman Tom Perez tweeted, Black women led us to victory, and we can't take that for granted, HMM, but I bet you will, and you know why? It's because Democrats know that black people aren't really Democrats. We just vote for the guy that looks less likely to put us on a boat. Here is how I vote. I look at both candidates. I listen to them speak, and then I ask myself, if I got pulled over, which one of these candidates would I rather see approaching my car? And it's almost always not the one on a horse. Mr. Jost, police in Illinois arrested a man for drunk driving after he crashed his car into a ditch and told officers that his name was Burger King. Police then took out their tasers and had it their way. Mr. Che, the FCC approved a controversial plan to repeal net neutrality regulations. The move was spearheaded by FCC Chairman Ajit Pai, who I assume Trump picked because he looked at him one time and thought, I bet this guy does computers. Poor Shaquille O'Neal. This week, SNL took on the popular TNT basketball studio crew, featuring Charles Barkley, Kenan Thompson, Kenny Smith, Chris Redd, Ernie Johnson, Alex Moffat, and Mr. O'Neill being played by Mr. Hart. And while there were some digs at Mr. Barkley, the real butt of the sketch was Mr. O'Neill. At one point, Mr. Hart wished those of the Jewish faith a happy harmonica. Much of the sketch was non sequiturs from the O'Neill character, which, if you've ever watched NBA games on TNT, isn't too far off. Here is a smattering. Shaq can't ride no horse, feet don't touch the ground. But you can't beat a dead horse, because dead horses tell no tales, because they're horses who lost their tails. Yeah, well, let me tell you something. Every dog has his day, but it's nighttime, no time for dogs, dogs don't sleep. So, it's cat time, cats come out at night, freaks come out at night, Shaq a freak. At one point, Mr. Thompson responded, Shaq, it's like a whole bunch of words got jumbled up in your brain, and the fire marshal said, everybody out. And then there was the physical comedy, when Mr. Hart emerged from behind the studio desk on stilts to convey Mr. O'Neill's height. Kudos to Mr. Hart here. His portrayal of Mr. O'Neill wasn't spot on by any stretch, but it was funny. It was surely a writer's dream, in which a bunch of random words could be thrown at a performer with a guarantee they would get laughs. Office phone call revolved around Mr. Hart, who, instead of just excusing himself and going to the restroom during meetings, concocts elaborate phone calls to leave. This was a great example of the surrounding cast somehow managing to not break character during a sketch that plays to Mr. Hart's strength being absurd. Tonight, we raise our glasses to those who have to play it straight in sketches. Thank you for watching. For the follow-up, subscribe to the channel yourself here. Mehdi Asyari. Tanzim Meysam Ekberi. قافل شدم از گوشه قلبم داری میری عاشق شدنم دست تو بود اینجا گیری قبلا که میگفتی تا دنیا دنیا هست هم صحبت تنهایی من میشینه میری از من دور دور
نشه که هر جور جون بگی میدم تو هم نفس من چی هم نفس من چی عشق و دل من چی زندگی من دل خوشی من